On the left side of Sky Temple, our blue team by the name of Dignitas, we have Chris on Tyrande, we have Nurok playing Sergeant Hammer, Link playing Malfurion, Salus playing, oh geez, what's that skin? Nazebo! And Blood Dragon is playing Stitches.
On the right hand side, we have the reshuffled alternate roster. Crowley on the Rhaegar going top right now, alongside Alan. And that is Aldrin on Valor and Tyrael, respectively. Their skins look so slim, similar. Moxio on Tassadar mid. And finally, down bottom, we have good old Gluhammer on the Falstad. And this is really where you expect Falstad to be here. It's going to be mid and top shrine to spawn first. Falstad's just going to be soaking XP and will fly up when he needs to.
Blood Dragon gaining control here of the Watchtower already. And usually in pub games, you see people going for the Watchtower, everyone going for the Watchtower, and then you either lose a member here early on, or lose a little bit of XP in the lanes. And this is why some teams have actually stepped away from just going for that must-have control early on. And I like it quite a bit. It's a good idea to just play it safe and not waste any XP in the lanes. Oh, Hook misses a little bit. Going for that minion.
So, even though they have this, they have no real support in this top lane, they're really playing around a pick strategy, our Dignitas. It's going to be Hook into Luna Flare to try and just try and burst someone down while Nurok's just going to be hammering away on them. And we're actually seeing the healing totem. Is there a healing totem in there? I think there was. There was a healing totem in the minion wave there to try and keep alternate sustained up. But it's shrine time.
Shrine time, and looks like both teams are going for that top shrine. Well, not really showing anything yet. Tassadar is pushing back Malfurion quite a bit in mid there, and keeping him on his toes. So not going for that mid temple just yet. And that mid temple is a little bit stronger than the top temple, since it does go for both sides at the same time.
Yeah. And so mid temple, it's able to get the tower on one of the sides. On like the keep, or the fort, sorry, so that you actually gain a little bit more XP than you would if you were to exhaust top temple of all of its bullets. And we actually see Nazebo just still sticking around in the bot lane. He feels no need to go up for this one. He's actually trading pretty well with Gluhammer here, but won't be able to get the kill. Uses his Envenom as they hit four, but again, just not enough damage.
Yeah, Gluhammer is in a bit of trouble down here, but he's not taking too much damage on the towers either. So he can stand his ground, and of course, Dignitas had solid control of this mid-shrine all the time. So they do get quite a few shots in. At the same time, a really strong push coming out of Alternate in the top lane. Already got rid of the towers, got rid of the gate, and have done quite a bit of damage on that first fort.
Yeah, they have. We're actually seeing a strange Rhaegar level 4 talent. As I was saying earlier, it's really hard to be a Rhaegar solo healer, and Alternate know this. They've gone for this chain reaction so that if Rhaegar heals a lightning shield enemy, they're going to get an increased heal. So he's really going to try and help out his front line here by just powering on the heals, powering on the shields, and try and keeping them alive as long as possible.
Yeah, and along those same lines, Tyrael also taking amplified healing to get a little bit extra healing in, 30% of all received healing and regeneration effects. So they definitely know, okay, we have to somehow keep up, get a little bit more sustain against the Malf-Tyrande combo. Ooh, and Tyrande going for the mule. Nice choice here, especially on Sky Temple, one of the best pickups.
So Alternate have just gained complete control of this bottom lane. They took their own easy camp and then went and stole Dignitas' easy camp as a three-man. It was Gluhammer, Mopsio, and Krulu. They were able to take them down really quickly and force Blood Dragon to clear them whilst creating a ton of pressure down the bot lane as well. So they've really gained themselves some freedom, and they're going to go straight for this top hard camp after it.
Yeah, really good map control so far from Alternate. They seem to be a little bit just mixed out. Really, really good teamwork so far, and both teams are incredibly even. I mean, they're just a little bit ahead, and oh, Krolu even waiting to take these bruises.
So, some teams actually, oh, that Tyrande are just missing, but some teams just wait until the shrine is up, and now you'll see Krolu take it. It's a big risk, yes, but if you get lucky with the shrine timing, it's not too big of a deal. Rhaegar was there for what, 10 seconds or so, just waiting to cap it. It's a good choice, but it's just going to be hard camp versus hard camp. They're going to fight 5v5 down here, and this is where one team could hit level 10 and just turn the tides.
Nice thing is, their hard camp is actually fighting a little bit closer to the wall. Oh, well, he could have taken a little bit later, and then they would have fought in tower range.
Yeah.
But like that, they're fighting in the middle. Both teams starting to get control of these temples here, but so far it's only Dignitas that has some really, really solid control. Blood Dragon pushing everyone out here, and Gloohammer can't seem to make his move. The hook does miss, and they're just pushing them back a little bit further, and that's the problem here. In this bottom temple, you can really get pushed back. Nice route here onto Krollo, and he's catching quite a bit of damage. Can he get away? Oh, he's so incredibly low, but he can save himself. Nazebo couldn't, though. And Adrin making out of there. Ellen also incredibly low, but just the ball to dash away. Blood Dragon has to get out of there. Gloohammer trying to chase. It looks like they got the best of this.
Chris will fall as well, so this is level 10 for alternate.
Ooh, nice shot! There comes the judgment onto Blood Dragon, and he does fall, but they need to still get that gate down, otherwise Adrin might fall here. Here comes the Ancestral Healing, still keep him alive, and they get that gate down. Perfect move here for alternate, though they need to watch out. Level 10 is now available for Team Dignitas, and they might try to push this back. Still, I have to say, I mean, they got that, got most shots off that bottom temple, so it wasn't all too bad for Dignitas.
Yeah, they just weren't able to get anything big from it. That fort is still on more or less 100% HP in the bottom lane on alternate side. They got the shots, but couldn't capitalize on it. I feel like Hammer really should have stayed sieged for most of that, because all she kept doing was auto-attacking, stepping back. If she had just stayed sieged a little bit safer, there might have been a bit more splash damage out, especially when there was the root in the left-hand entrance to the shrine on Rhaegar and Valor. That would have been an ideal position for Hammer to get some damage out. And we can see with these heroic choices from Dignitas that they're really going for an AoE sustained style of fight. We've got the Starfall, the Ravenous Spirit, and the Putrid Vial for Stitches. So it's essentially a big area that's going to have damage dealing over time. It's going to be a large area of a slow, and then you're going to have the Ravenous Spirit just doing its thing.
Yeah. And I'm really interested once that actually comes into play here. Dignitas only one level down, so that next team fight is going to decide some things quite a bit here. And we've not seen the Ravenous in action yet, so let's see, down here in the bot lane, Alternate is pushing this quite a bit with two Siege Shines, and only Malfurion and Sergeant Hammer are in lane right now. Are they going to finish this off? Just let those Siege Shines go by themselves. That's it, I guess.
That's all she wrote. So, Valor's now rotated up to join Mopsio in this mid lane. They're going to try and clear this one up. And we're at the polar opposites. We've got the North Pole and the South Pole. Shrines are spawning. So this is where Falstad really comes into play. Falstad could just happily sit top after now forcing Chris out of the lane. Of course, there's no fountain up there, so he has to fall back or at least sustain himself up. Falstad could take this one solo, and then we could see the rest of alternate move down and contest this bottom shrine as a 4v4 to start, and then Falstad could fly. But it seems like they just want to take top as a pairing and just soak XP from the lanes. They know they're ahead, they don't really have to risk anything.
Yeah, that is a valid option. I would have loved for Rhaegar to just put down two totems to help out Gloohammer a little bit, and then for him to move down later on. But now, Rhaegar is moving down, and so is Falstad. Looks like they do want to contest this temple, but most shots, or more than half of the shots, have been gone off. And are they going to make their move here? Nuroc already catching quite a bit of damage, and there comes the engage out of Adrin. And a nice shock and awe in the back there. Chris taking quite a bit of damage. He is pushed back, but they're going to focus down Linked, and he does fall. Alan trying to get out of there, but there comes the Ancestral, the Ravenous Spirit. Doesn't quite get him, and Tyrande does fall here later on. Mopsio still trying to stop their Blood Dragon, but even with the shield, he's catching quite a bit of damage. But that's three heroes down, and now Dignitas definitely on the run here. Krollo catches that hook, but he does get away. No real follow-up. Even Adrin coming in to kill Nazebo. What a pickup here for Team Alternate.
Yep, definitely. So it was the Hinterland Blast that came in from Falstad there. It hit at least three members. It did so much damage to Chris and really forced him out of the fight. He was there at the back, and they didn't care. They were happy to leave him there for a while, just let Adrin go back and kill him afterwards, while the rest of the team focused down the carries, the Nazebo, the Stitches, the Malfurion. And it was a solid fight from Alternate. Two level lead now. 1.5 to be fair, as they now get the bot fort as well, while Falstad finishing up off top. Tarande can't really go in here again. It's the 1.5 level lead, soon going to be a talent lead as well, and Alternate really going to look to try and snowball from there and take the fight.
Yeah, and this is especially easy here on Sky Temple, because once you do get that level advantage, it's just so easy to hold the temples. Your opponents are just going to wait for you to make a little bit of a mistake to maybe go for two temples at once. Oh, Nuro catching quite a bit of damage here. Gloomhammer coming in, but there's the first aid, and Valor is actually taken out with the help of Chris. Nice move. This is what Dignitas has to do here to come back. Get these little easy pickups.
They do, but these 16 talents are now in. We've got triple blood for blood, so...
Jeez.
Yeah, so much percentage health. That's going to be more or less 50% of a hero's health. Imagine that on stitches. That's so much damage down just from three talents that then a Hinterland Blast will just probably be enough to finish it off. So, Tyrael's mainly going for it for the chase potential. Valor's got it for the self-peeling option, so you've got Vault and Blood for Blood just to help you get out of there. And then, of course, Rhaegar's got it for a bit of both. Help him peel for his assassins, but also try and chase down, of course.
Ooh, Dignitas. Really ballsy here. Going for the steal in the siege camp. They do manage to get it, but just because Falstad was completely out of position and still trying to go for that top lane.
So again here, on the 13 talent for Rhaegar, we've got Healing Surge coming in, increasing the heal on the first target, and you add some more AoE healing in there, it gets another target. Really going for this healing style of Rhaegar that we don't see too much. I'm trying to think what talent you usually see at 13. It's the... What is it?
I'm not
Damn,
sure.
That's going to bug me.
We but can look it up in between games.
Yeah, that's going to annoy me otherwise, but yeah, really going for this solo heal style of Rhaegar. Try and support his team as much as possible. As they're trying to sneak around and catch Dignitas off guard. They actually learn the return stun onto Krolu, gets hooked in, and now the ancestral healing being used. They're going to back out from this one.
Oh, Dignitas should really capitalize on that. Once ancestral healing gone, they could actually go for a fight here, and the bottom temple is coming up in 10 seconds. That's a perfect time for them to engage. Let's see if they make it happen. Blood Dragon coming in. There comes the engage out of Adrian, but he gets out of there. And really, really solid shields here. Good work by Marzio. He's shielding everyone and keeping them alive. But Dignitas is pushing in. And it's a perfect time. Some of these defenders have popped, but Link, oh my gosh, what that damage output out of Adrian. And Nazeevo not doing all that much. Marzio has to get out of the fight now. But Alan trying to come in from the back here again. Slow. Chris is actually quite low, but so is most of Alternate. Just kind of push Sailors out of this fight. And that is a pretty good idea. Nurok pops that first aid, still stays alive. And Adrian popping in there once again, going for a nice little body block, going for Tyrande. And now Nurok caught out of position, and they do get him once again. And still have about half shots left here on that temple. Really nice move by Team Alternate. And yep. Blood Dragon, oh my gosh, he's gonna fall here as well. There comes a storm and a nice little follow-up here by Adrian.
So, Ancestral Healing is actually a relatively short cooldown, and they were able to use it again at the end of that fight because it's only 60 seconds. And before I annoy myself even more, it's Feral Lunge at 13 on Rhaegar.
Ah,
and
then
you,
lunge.
Yeah, I thought that was a 16 talent for some reason, but at 16 you usually see the Earth Grasp Totem, which has the increased range on the totem, and of course is a 90% slow, but Blood for Blood is understandable at the moment. They're adding more damage to their lineup, which they certainly looked like they lacked in their pick screen, but now they've been able to capitalize on that great fight down bottom with not only the shrine, but they've now got the boss as well, and they may even look to try and take the siege giant camp here as well.
Yeah, I think they're going to do it eventually. I think Dignitas will be occupied with this boss for quite some time, but that was a really amazing fight. Did you check out how that zoning worked for Alternate? They really pushed Nazeebo out of that fight. The ultimate didn't do all that much, and then they just picked them off one by one.
Yeah, and they were able to burst down Link so quickly that he wasn't really able to get the tranquility off and try and heal any damage that Alternate tried to output.
Yeah, and that's the problem if we play someone like Malfurion on Sky Temple, because it's so hard to keep that overview of where your opponent is coming from, and it's really hard to zone someone out like that. And maybe they're even going for the steal. The Bruisers here, certainly gearing up to do it. Here comes the Mule onto the Fort, which is going to keep it alive for a little bit longer. And this is going to put Dignitas in a nice position to defend their Bruisers, so it's not going to happen. Alternate, instead opting to go for their own Bruiser camp, which is definitely the safer option here.
Yeah, it really is the safer option. They've got enough time as well. This Temples came up with 28 seconds until activation, so plenty of time for them. The question now is, are they going to be able to soak enough XP to get level 20 before these shrines activate? The answer is probably no. And they're going to maybe look to force the engage beforehand and try and burst up Chris.
Ooh. Yeah, he did catch quite a bit of damage, but does get out of there and heal himself back up. But they're trying to make their move. Blood Dragon goes in there again. Can't really seem to find their angle. They're being pushed out. Maybe they're actually not going for this, but instead opting to go for the top shrine. At least Gloohammer is, and I don't think they're going to fight here without their entire team in position.
Yeah, it's going to be a point now where they just wait for level 20, and Dignitas realize this, and they're going to rotate straight back up because they know the Alternate aren't happy to fight in these situations. They don't want to, and as we say, that Blood Dragon is going to take quite a bit of damage, but gets healed up by Malfurion. As Alternate, they're going to rotate straight back to mid and try and get this mid. Well, they've already got the mid 4. So they're now really close to getting level 20.
Really, really nice move here. Unfortunately, top Fort will probably fall here with the Bruisers on the way and only Gloohammer defending. And they still have those shots from the temple. Still, I think mid Fort going down is going to help out. And that keep also taking quite a bit of damage. But they're rotating up again, trying to catch someone while they're retreating, but it's not going to happen. They smelled it and got out of there just in the nick of time.
Yeah, Tyrael could have judgmented if they really wanted, but they didn't have any idea when Zeebo or Stitches were, so it was a pretty big risk. And this is one of the longest temple phases I've seen, because they're just rotating between each temple where Ardrain gets
caught. There's the hook! Perfect hook, and a nice zombie wall to follow it up, but with Ancestry healing, and of course, that blink out of there. There comes the judgment onto Chris. Can they pop him? Wow, Felset with the Hinterland Blast from the back, but they need to stop Sailors. Yep, and he does it. Nice interrupt here on the Heroic, and Sailas is dropping, but can he get out of there? Looks like Sailas might be able to port back. Sergeant Hammer wasn't so lucky, and Blood Dragon Link should get out of there, but this is going to be another strong push here for Alternate. Maybe they even get that keep with this push. On the Zeebo, actually porting out of there.
Sailas is able to get out of there, but it looks like, again, Alternate with their superior mercenary control, they're just going to be happy to grab at least their own ET camp here, and they could certainly go and try and take the enemies, because that'd be pretty safe right now. 5 versus 3, I'm surprised they're not doing so. Valor and Tyrael are going to tap Fountain, and now they're going to join the team and try and force this one, which should be relatively free. Blood Dragon and Sailas are the closest two, but unless Blood Dragon just lands a crazy good hook, then this is safe for Alternate. This is theirs, and there it is.
Yeah, perfect pickup. And Alternate really seems to be like a completely different team. If I compare it to the Alternate that I knew a couple months ago, and then even to the Alternate since they've been in a decline, this is a really, really nice team. And they've been working together and playing it really, really safe compared to a little bit of the, we're just going in, dishing as much damage as we can, and just hope for the best kind of style that they used to play for a while.
Yeah. And it's that time of the game again, and these 4 Siege Giants have just done so much damage. Alongside some team members of Alternate, they've got the gate. But again, are Dignitas really going to look to fight this? 19-21? I don't think they are, and Alternate know this. They're going to try their hand at boss, because Dignitas thought they've gone for a shrine. Nurok looked like he wanted to check that one out. They're just going to give this to him. Tarande now knows. They're going to get this for free, and are they going to push with it, or like, are they going to contest? I think contesting is the best idea.
Yeah, I do think so as well. I mean, the boss is just going to do damage, and is going to force a reaction out of Dignitas, which means there's at least one member that's not joining in here for the temples.
Well, the boss could, in theory, grab this keep. The boss on Sky Temple is so strong. It'll go for the fountain first, but after that, it's going straight for the keepers. We see yet another rotation to this top shrine. Dignitas are committed to this. They've just hit 20 as well.
Oh, Nurok is trapped down there. They also forced out Sailas. He's not going to add it to this fight all too soon. And there's the engagement out to Link, and another nice Hinterland Blast. Link does drop, Blood Dragon pushing Gloohammer back, and a nice heal by Crowley does keep him alive. Tyrande is killed here, and Blood Dragon on the retreat. Nurok will stay alive for a little bit longer. Sailor's already popped his heroic as well. Only another napalm strike to keep Nurok alive. And Aiden still going for the chase. There does Stitches fall, and Alan coming in from the back, and even gets out of there. What a vault, and a nice shield here from Tassler to keep Alan alive.
Meanwhile, bot lane, the boss was able to grab the keep and still have half of its HP left. Now Nazebo and Hammer have the base. Yeah, you've really got to think this is game here. 45 seconds on Stitches, 30 on Tyrande, 24 on Malfurion, and it was that tactic of blowing him up before he could do anything. He wasn't even able to root. I'm pretty sure he didn't even land a Moonfire in there. It was just straight up burst down. You are not healing your team. And that's one of the problems with Malfurion at the moment. If he gets taken down early on in the fight, you're A, already committed to it, so you feel you have to persist, and B, you're going to try and persist, but you're really not going to be able to do anything because you'll die so quickly. And here it is. The core taking its first damage, 95%.
Yeah, but they're not going for it. They're still choosing the safe route. This is a different alternate. I like it. It's maybe not as thrilling, but still, it's safer. It's the way you want to play this out.
Yeah, because essentially, next Temple Shrine is theirs. So long as they survive, and in fact, the next one I believe is going to be all three shrines.
Yeah.
It should be all three shrines. It might not be, but it should be. As now you're going to have Volstead on one, Alternate Contest in one, and then Dignitas trying to get themselves around the map to fight this, which they just won't be able to do. So you've really got to imagine right now that Alternate, they're in the driving seat. Next Temple Shrine, so long as they don't do anything wrong, it's their game.
We have double Storm Shield for Dignitas. Tyrande and Malfurion going for the Storm Shield, and of course the Hardened Shield onto Stitches. So they know we want to go for sustain as much as possible and try to stay alive in this in these fights. But the problem is, Alternate is just doing such an amazing job focusing down the supports and just getting them down so quickly with their spike damage. And it's always the same setup. It's always Judgment into Hinterland Blast, and they're just set up so perfectly. Gloohammer and Adrian just doing a perfect job here for Alternate.
Yes, though, they've really had to be forced to take this double Storm Shield. So Malfurion's going to get shielded for 40% of his max health. They're having no trouble getting rid of 100% of his health at the moment, but that 40% might be the difference.
Oh, I'd imagine this might be a backdoor. Alternate is thinking about it.
There's no real need to backdoor this. They've got they've got one Siege Camp and one Catapult already in there. It's going to be joined by another Catapult. I wouldn't be surprised if we see Falstad just fly top now and abandon his team, but it looks like they actually want to take this fight now.
Oh, Blood Dragon actually singled out here, but they're going for Chris once again. There's the Judgment, and Reign of Vengeance coming in as well. Oh, Linked going for that fight, but he's in the middle of everything. Nurok drops down. Link was there a little bit too late, and Salus, of course, fought out there. Blood Dragon still on the run here. Everyone of Alternate, except for Falstad, is still alive, and they still have a lot of health here. Link is going to drop, and Blood Dragon still turning around. But I think it's going to be Alternate. Just goes for the temples, get these shots off, and then go for the core. Going for two temples at the same time, and I think this is the perfect decision here. Krolo and Mopsio can just fight Blood Dragon and push him out of here.
Yeah, this is essentially game. GG's being called. Two temples going, hammering down the core. It's essentially you're just not able to stop it. So, actually a pretty convincing game there, coming out from Alternate. Both teams drafted a little bit strangely for my liking, but obviously Alternate, they used their comp well. They knew exactly what they were doing with it, and it really showed that early game was strong. They had great rotations, they had great merc control, and that really gave them the upper hand moving into that mid-late game stage.
Yeah, this is a really old-school team composition by our blue team on the left side. They are Team Dignitas here on Cursed Hollow, and we have Link playing Uther, Nurok playing Sergeant Hammer, Salus playing Vala. In the mid lane, it is Chris on Illidan, and in the bot lane, Blood Dragon playing Shen.
And the right-hand side, going into this match, 1-0 up. They need to win this one to secure themselves. The match win over Dignitas is Team Alternate. Alan on the Tyrande in the top lane. This tri-lane setup in mid is going to be Mopsio, Gloohammer, and Kroluan. Down bot, all by himself, is Ardren on ETC, and that bot lane is going to be so boring to watch. Chen versus ETC.
Oh, no one's going to drop low.
Tickling versus tickling. Who's going to tickle hard enough?
Huh? Looks like there's a little bit of a rotation happening here. Mopsio, Krolu, and Alan all going down. Adrian going up again. They might have to switch back, because usually you see the party lane versus each other.
Yeah, it's... So, what teams usually do is they hang around in mid and see where is Hammer. I want to be in the lane versus Hammer so we can de-push this. And if you look at it, Alternate don't really have too much to de-push this. You usually have a Valor or a Tasta to go against Hammer and get some damage down and de-push the lane. But look at this tower in top already. It's had a third of its health gone, nearly half of it now. But
oh, there's the hook onto Durok behind enemy lines. Jeez, he's going to drop so quickly. How did that happen?
Stitches was in front of it, and I think
he just pushed him through it.
Yeah.
That was a nice displace.
Yeah, now let's get a ton more of those, and there it is again.
Another one here onto Link, and a nice pushback by ETC to follow it up. Where's the body block? There it is. Adrian going for the second kill here for Team Alternate. What an opening. You were talking about how do you push Sergeant Hammer back. This is how you do it.
That was...
You're speechless.
So, Mopsio... I know Mopsio just spams a ton of Stitches games. He is one of the most played Stitches players in EU. And it really showed you right there. He's got 100% hook rate and 100% kill rate because of those hooks. Those are stats that you just need on your team.
Yeah. He is an incredible Stitches player, and finally back into form. I really love to see it. Mopsio is such a great guy. He's a really nice guy as well. Oh, there's the first hook that actually misses. And Link and Nurk pushing back here. Alan coming in from the back. And Adrian pushing Link back, but I think he has too much sustain. Oh, there's a good move here by Tyrande with that nice little shot there.
They
and
don't have
healing
damage,
ward put down.
But they have CC. And that's all you need. With the Hunter's Mark, you get a little bit more damage on your side, but just look at what they have. They have Hook, into Lunar Flare, into Face Melt, and then into Power Slide. That's 4 CCs across 3 heroes against 2 heroes with no escapes and a Valor.
Yep.
And speaking of escapes, they're going to escape this top lane and rotate their way down to this tribute, but you've got to think that Hammer may stay and just counteract this by pushing.
Yeah, she's going to push quite a bit. ETC is going to have trouble dealing with this. I don't think that Dignitas will actually rotate down to go for this tribute. They're just going to let it go. Krolu already has that pretty much taken care of. And yeah, returning into lanes as soon as he can. Stitches, in the meantime, he did take that mid lane. So Chris can't really do all that much. And they're rotating back up again. And it's going to be that dangerous triple lane once again here for Alternate.
I wouldn't be surprised if we just see a Stitches hook. Okay, yeah. Hammer unseaged at the right time, because otherwise Mopsio could have just hooked straight. And because you see the outline of Hammer's range, you know exactly where Hammer is, even if you don't have sight. You can just go straight for that hook and land it, but didn't go for it this time, playing it a little bit safe. And Dignitas, because they were able to get these two towers in top, now have the XP lead, but of course, one tribute down, it's not the best. They are going to react to this by grabbing their easy camp up top, and that's going to help them immensely as the next tribute spawns down bot.
Oh, this is actually a really cool placement for Alternate. Are they going to go for it? They might have to give up a little bit of lane presence if they want to go for it, but looks like they are in position already. Uther and Valor going, trying to go for it, but not really sure if they want to. Mopsio, he could go for that hook and misses, unfortunately.
Yeah, they're just trying to go for the delay here, but 3 versus 3, you've got to think that, again, Alternate have the upper hand. Even 4 versus 4, now that Chen joins, they still have the upper hand. Gloohammer, though, is a little bit split here. They're actually going to go in.
Oh, Mopsio's in the trap. There's a Savage coming out, and he catches so much damage that he has to drop. Link is quite low as well. He has to get out of that fight. So is Salus, but Chris is still up on top, and Raynor does fall here. So this does give nice control into that tribute for them. Alan might actually fall here as well. Chris is on the hunt, and he goes for it. What a nice fight here for Dignitas. They're paying back.
They are indeed. And meanwhile, Hammer's been pushing top alongside these Siege Giants. ETC just cannot get close. He steps forward, he gets slowed by the mines, he gets auto-attacked by Hammer. and that's just trying to get towards the Siege Giants. The best thing he could do would be to power slide in and face melt them back, but here comes a wild Mopsio.
And where's that hook? There it is, but it misses by just an inch here. But that's two warriors. They can deal with those Siege Giants. Actually push them a little bit closer to the fort, make it a little bit safer here. But they are quite behind. One level advantage here for Team Dignitas. And it's a big one. It's level 10. Let's have a look at their talents. Metamorphosis on Illidan. Rain of Vengeance on Vala. Wandering Keck, of course, on Shen. The Napalm Strike on Sergeant Hammer. And Divine Storm on Uther. So no real surprises.
Yeah. Standard across the board here for Dignitas. Vala going to obviously have an ETC and probably Stitches going towards her. So again, that Rain of Vengeance is going to help immensely. We actually see the auto attack build coming out as well from Vala, which again makes sense versus that double tank lineup, plus the healing of Rhaegar Tyrande. And Alternate are almost trying to bait Dignitas in here. They are 4 versus 3. Vala's going to join soon, but Chris is already in here.
Oh, and Mopsio dropping his heroic as well, but he drops incredibly low. Adrian coming in there from the back, but he's not doing all that much. Link is quite low. He's catching a few shots from that Starfall, but Nurok trying to block them out. And there was a nice little steal here on those bruisers. And dropping Stitches out of that fight was just immense. They're really focusing on Mopsio in all of these fights.
Yeah, and also we have the level 10 here for Alternate. They're doing what Dignitas tried to do last game, which was with the Putrid Bile Starfall kind of thing. But they've now added Hyperion in and Mosh Pit as well. I didn't really expect Mosh Pit to be taken here considering how big of a map it is and the interrupt potential that Vala just has. Right now, ETC has to get Vala in that Mosh Pit or it's most likely going to be interrupted. But you can see how their heroics are going to combine. Mosh Pit on a 2 or 3, Putrid Bile around them, Starfall on top of them, Hyperion going on top of them. Again,
it's all very AoE based.
Yeah. You usually see AoE burst comps, but this one is very much AoE sustained.
And it's a little bit harder to pull off. It's gonna rely quite heavily on Mopsio trying to go for Vala or Illidan there to get him out of that fight, and especially stop Vala, because her interrupts could just put an end to all of these heroics.
The boss gets taken. That's 2 for 2 for Dignitas. They grab their enemy's boss, then find safe haven in taking their own, and they're actually going to contest this siege camp here. And look at this, the 2-level difference and the talent advantage. Even 3 versus 3, they force Alternate to back away for this one.
Yeah, and Alternate has to back off. They're cursed. They have that boss that they have to take care of, and of course 2-level disadvantage here. So this is quite a biggie. We have double Giant Killer on Vala, on Sergeant Hammer, as well as the Sprint on Uther. 6 cents taken by Illidan to reduce a little bit of damage while he has Evasion active. And Chen, not quite ready with his level 14 talent there. 13.
As they're actually going to go in onto Alan here, they can find so many ults that Ancestral Healing goes down in time, but Alan will fall.
Oh, and Adrian caught out there. Rain of Vengeance are down on top of him. He does fall as well. And that's ETC and Tyrande down. It's going to be quite hard for Alternate to stop this onslaught. And the bottom keep will definitely fall. Voss still has most of his health. Wow, this might be a really early finish, but the cooldowns are still quite low. Rolu has to drop out of that fight, but they're focusing on the core really quickly here.
As soon as the shield goes, it's game. Hey, this is game. 9 minutes.
Wow, what a fast game here for Dignitas, and so well deserved.
After a dominating performance on Sky Temple from Alternate, Dignitas just come out and are like, right, we've had enough of you. We're just going to beat you in 9 minutes, 8 seconds, and there it was. It was the second tribute where they fought 4 versus 4 and were able to trade 2 for 0. They were able to get that XP lead, hit level 10s, and then have so much great map pressure and map presence and just know exactly where Alternate were at exactly the right times.
Yeah, it was just perfect. I mean, it started so promising for Alternate, and it was just like we said in the beginning, looks like the draft is going to Alternate, so I guess Dignitas has to win. If our predictions are correct, the next draft winner will lose that game and lose the series. But I mean, of course, not everything is decided in draft.
Dignitas came back and won in 9 minutes on Cursed Hollow.
one of the fast Cursed Hollow games I've ever seen. And here they are, on the left side, on Garden of Terror, they are Team Dignitas, up 1-1 versus Alternate. And we have Linked playing Rhaegar, Chris playing ETC, Bloody Dragon playing Stitches, and in the bot lane, Salus playing Sergeant Hammer, and Nurok on Raynor.
And Alternate, this is now essentially a BO1 for both teams. They had the luxury of coming in as the leaders, going 1-0 up, and then dropping the Cursed Hollow map in very strange fashion. Gluehammer on the top lane, Nazebo. Three men mid right now in the form of Mopsio, Ardren, and Alan. And in the bot lane, all by himself, is Krolu playing the Medic Uther.
That's definitely one of the nicest skins for Uther.
Yes. Yes, it is.
And mid lane with a triple stack. Interesting way to play this. It might have to rotate down just to deal with that other triple stack in the bot lane by Dignitas. This looks like a nice lane setup.
Are they going... What are they doing? Are they going for a three-man roam squad here because they know ETC's wave clear at level 1 isn't great? It looks like that's what they're doing. Okay, no Tasters. He's toying with the idea, should I stay or should I go to bot lane? And it looks like he just wants to stay mid. He didn't really want to risk much there. So they're happy going 3v3 down here. They don't really have the wave clear to deal with the hammer push that's going to come in on them. But nighttime is up in 25 seconds. I expect Nazebo to maybe play a little bit safer up top and grab his own seeds. And then probably Tassadar will join the bot lane force and try and contest those, I think.
Yeah, Nazebo definitely has to watch out here. If there are any good hooks coming out, he's in trouble. And he knows this. Turning around before all the minions dissipate, definitely a better idea to go for. They might even swap, but looks like it's not happening for now. Knight has fallen, and he's going for the first few free seats over here. In the meantime, Dignitas also catching theirs down here. Kind of funny that they're not going for the top Schlember, though. Since it is a little bit closer to their side of the map.
They're gonna go for it now, Alternate. They're gonna actually leave Diablo to solo this one. He gets far-sighted by Rhaegar. I haven't seen that one in a while, but it makes sense on a map like Garden of Terror where you get so much information from it. And of course, it's on a lower cooldown than, say, Uther's Clairvoyance. So it's understandable as to why he'd take that. The Amplified Healing as well. We actually have double Gathering Power on Zeratul and Nazebo. Really going for a late game style here and just try and go for a interesting source of damage, let's say. It's not a conventional source.
Yeah, also a little bit of a different build here on Diablo, going for Devil's Dew, reducing his resurrection cost to 60 souls.
Yeah.
So usually you see the increased soulstone aggregation, but he's not going for that.
No, and they're actually going to take their hard camp very early on, our Alternate. And they may transition over to their easy camp after Ardren is able to tap the fountain. They're going to get some help from Nazebo here. Diablo can only tank so much. Get some extra damage down. But a 3-minute hard camp here, and now it's going to get CV'd out a little bit too late. But even so, that's pretty impressive. Good timing there from Alternate to grab that one. It's going to push the top lane as both teams go into this level 7 talent with 90 seeds each. They're happy being even, but what talents are we going
to
see?
Oh, Blood Dragon needs to watch out, and what a great zombie wall into Blood Dragon. It's going to dissipate quite soon, and he does get away, but that was a little bit too close for comfort for our Stitches player. And yeah, as you said, this is an incredibly strong push here by the hands of Alternate. They're doing this so well. Adrian comes in to help it out. Ooh, barely missing that hook. A little bit too soon, just before the gate got away. Already doing quite a bit of siege damage here, 17,000, but so is Vala down here. Vala and Reyna did quite a bit of work here, and the gates are down. They're also going in with their bruisers. And, well, I think Krolu might need some help down here. Three bruisers still alive. We might see a rotation out of some of these heroes. But no, they're going for the siege camp beforehand.
Yep, and Linked farsighted this one. Stitches has only just taken his level 7 talent. It's a pretty big debate. Obviously wanting to go for that damage. He's got the increased toxic gas, increases duration and size by 25%. So Pretty good there for him, adding to his damage total. When you have an ETC on your team, you have the freedom to go for that.
Nurok is in trouble. There comes the storm. Does push Alan back, but Adrian comes in, slams him against the wall, and there is Alan jumping in with a nice cleave to take him out. And that's first blood going to Team Alternate, and they're pretty much dead even with the experience, but Alternate getting a little bit boost here.
Yeah, a roam squad of Diablo and Zeratul not only brings you two forms of CC from the Diablo, but a ton of damage from the Zeratul, and of course the slow as well. And take a quick look at Zeratul's talents. Of course, he took block level 1, gathering power, and into first aid. So playing a safe Zeratul for now. Sometimes you see regen master on Zeratul at level 1, but because they have this Reyna in there, the hammer as well, wanting to go for that block to try and help him out survive the initial burst that comes out as soon as he shows himself.
Oh, interesting. We're seeing Apocalypse on the Diablo. Yep. Of course, one of the ways to get rid of ETC, because he did take... Oh, he took Stage Dive. Okay.
Yeah.
So going for go for the mobile talent here on one of the biggest maps in the game.
Which is understandable. Also, the Apocalypse is good for Sergeant Hammer if Hammer doesn't take Resistant at level 1. Hammer's taken Resistant at level 1. So that Apocalypse is going to do very little. It's what, a 2-second stun? That's going to be a 0.5 second stun onto Hammer. It's going to allow no time, but we're actually going to see Crowley get engaged upon.
Oh, he needs to watch out. He's being body blocked here quite a bit, but can he get away? Nope. Popping his heroic, but still, he's so incredibly low. Can he heal himself? No. Not in time. And they're not going to push this. They're going for the bottom chamber here. Luther just being a little bit ballsy there, but of course he can just do whatever he wants in that ghost form. Be a bit of a nuisance.
Yeah.
Alternate got their shamble down a little bit faster, so they could go for some counter-aggression here. But it seems a little bit too risky. Uther is still on cooldown. He's going to be back in 1 second. And there we go. They have their shamble on the way, though. Wapsio is in there.
So for the second night time in a row, they're just like, we'll take our 90 seeds, you can take your 90 seeds, we'll be happy, we'll stay the same, everybody's even. Speaking of Link's health bar is not even.
Oh yeah, definitely not. He's even being polymorphed there, but he does get away. That was pretty close. And this is going to be quite the offensive advantage to Alternate here. Link already being back up, still has most of his mana pool available. And we're just going to see the dance of death here around this fort. Still, nice little offensive positioning for Alternate. That gives you a little bit of an edge here, and you just need to watch out. Once you need to get out fast and just retreat with your entire team.
We actually have ETC just pushing this bot before. He's going to get that one in time, and he should still be able to stage dive before this fight even starts. It's just a slapping fight right now between the Terrors, a plant here and there, and some polymorphs being thrown out, but it's not...
gonna drop out a little bit sooner, and I think this might be the starting part to engage, but you can already see Alternate kind of retreating back. They still want to get this kill on the fort, and they might be able to do it. There comes the sprint in, and mobs are being pushed back once again. Come on, he needs to get out the stage dive. Nope, not happening. Just a napalm strike.
No, while they're Terra's top, they don't want to engage 4v4. Because who are they losing? They're losing Stitches? It's Stitches in the Terra. So again, you don't really want to lose one of your tanks. You don't really want to engage when you don't have a tank physically there with you. Until, of course, he stage dives in. Both plants are now run out. Nothing really transpired during that period of time. I mean, they got mid fort just about, and they responded by getting a tower top. Yes. And now teams are just happy to go and take their merc camps. They don't want to contest each other right now. They know that this map is essentially a best of one. They don't want to risk anything. Whereas maybe in the first game we saw really nice mercenary control early on from Alternate by taking the enemy's easy camp. Right now they know this game's on a knife edge, 14 levels each. Anything could happen right now, and it would be so easy for one team just to overstep their boundary.
Yeah, so it's definitely the safer route. That's why we're also seeing a lot of clairvoyance being popped here on the side of Dignitas. They have a little bit of an edge, just one level, and gonna try to play this out later on. Maybe if they get their level 16s a little bit earlier, they could try and force a team fight. But I think we're gonna have a nightfall before then, and they're gonna be occupied just going for their seats if they can.
Yeah, Mopsio is going to have to push out this bot lane because, of course, the Merkkampfer was taken prior. Dignitas did the exact same in top, mid lane. The easy camps have dissipated. They're actually going to engage onto Alan. He should be able to get out of here and blink away. Takes a lot of damage before doing so. In fact, pops the first aid. So, strange stuff from him. Wasted one of his talents here. Now Uth is here to try and help him out.
Oh, there's Chris behind the wall. He pushes everyone back and the Hyperion comes out. And Chris still fighting here. Didn't have a follow-up ready. Nazeba wasn't in position. Neither was Zeratul. A little bit unfortunate. Otherwise, this could have been a nice engagement point for Alternate. Now they're catching quite a bit of damage due to that Hyperion. But the fort will still stand. And they're going to go for some seeds here.
Yep, and they're actually going to contest for the first time.
Yeah, let's see if it works. Nice position on Gloohammer. And Alan jumps in onto Chris, but he has to go out again. Not nearly close enough. And Gloohammer being gorged here. Blood Dragon is pushed back. There comes the Apocalypse. Blood Dragon can't really get out of there. And there comes the Ancestral Healing. Gloohammer incredibly low. A great Divine Storm. And a good follow-up here by Zeratul. Nice Void Prison. Awesome escape here for Alternate. But they might still lose Gloohammer. He's incredibly low. And Chris still on the hunt for him. Rolo also being pushed back. But looks like everyone gets out of this safely. And that was quite a close call here for Alternate. But what a perfect disengage here with that Void Prison. Really good job by Alan.
Yeah, and Alan's even just going to go back in, get some more damage down. But even so, they didn't get any seeds from this, and they've lost all control of this top Shambler and the plants alongside it. So they're losing 90 seeds from this. They're going to have to try their best to grab bot. But I'm pretty sure, yeah, Dignitas could easily get down here in time, and it looks like that's what they
do. There's the Clairvoyance. They might have to abort this. Adrian jumps in there. They want to try to get at least a few seeds. I think they might have to stop this. There comes the hook onto Alan, and he's dropping quite low, but a good heal and first aid popping. There's the Nazeebo, trying to go on top of everyone, but Blood Dragon, he's being healed up again. Alan does get away there on the right side, and Adrian does so as well, but Gloohammer being pushed there in the middle of everyone, and sprints away. Can they all get away again? Rolo might not be so lucky this time. He also sprints away. Oh, it's gonna be so close. But they make it once again. That is insane.
Wants blood.
Alternate, the masters of retreat here.
Alan's moving like he wants kills. And Mopsio's joining him here. No, Alan decides against it. He's a smart guy. They got enough to grab their plant though, so it's all good. It could have been a lot worse. Losing no players there. The fact that this game is still 1-for-1 in kills just boggles the mind. But Ardren, he was playing so aggressive. He was lucky that they actually farsighted that instead of face checking him. Because the farsight made Ardren aware that they knew his position. Whereas if they'd have just face checked, it would have ended pretty badly. They actually want to engage here.
This is interesting. They don't want to lose too many seeds. Oh, Chris is being pushed out here quite a bit. Can he save himself? I mean, they have that garden chair to keep everyone back, but Adrian already quite low. I don't think they want to lose him right now. Oh, there's the polymorph. They want to engage, push him back, and he's going to fall here. Or is he? Wow, what a turnover.
Shields.
Wow, keeping his cool. Alternate really are the masters of retreat. That's for sure.
Even if he'd have died there, he had enough souls to resurrect, so it wouldn't have been too big a deal. It just would have been a little bit of XP going in the opposite direction. Alternate, though, contrary to last time, they actually have their plant a little bit longer and it's a little bit healthier here, so they could get some counter aggression for 10 seconds or so when there's a difference in plants. But again, it'd be a little bit risky. We're still only 1-4 down on each side. The bot lane is down for Alternate. Of course, TTC took that one earlier. And mid down for Dignitas. That was the last Garden Terror that took that one.
ETC is really making the best of his mobility here, clearing the lanes as fast as he can. He's trying to push that bot lane. Oh, Blood Dragon might be pushed out, but nope. I think the rest of his team is doing a good enough job to just keep him safe. Powers will fall here, but only 6 seconds remaining. I don't think that Alternate is going to push this too hard. Would be a little bit too risky. And Alan will pop out of that Garden Terror now. And they're going to retreat, of course. Maybe deal with ETC down there, but he can get away if he needs to.
The more worrying thing here for Alternate is that Dignitas have another plant ready and waiting.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, they got so many seeds in that last night.
And this isn't even going to be worth their time or mana or effort taking these camps. They're going to take the easy camp. But the Gontar is just going to stick a plant pot down in mid and that easy camp will disappear so quickly. Or they're going to run into a hammer. They're going to do the hard camp as well.
I think it's just damage control, to be honest.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there's the clairvoyance a little bit too late. But they know that they just have to get a few people in lanes to deal with this. And they're going to push quite hard with this next Garden Terror. This might be game deciding if they manage to pull it off.
Yeah, because up until now it's been Garden Terror versus Garden Terror. But for the first time, we actually have a situation where the Garden Terror could go and split push. That's Blood Dragon. And the rest of the team try and fight 4v4 while someone defends top.
Oh, and linked.
With Opsio already on half HP, it's certainly an option.
Yeah, they're going to stop those Sea Giants in mid lane, and there's a rotation. And ETC is pushing bot.
He's got a hard camp.
Oh yeah, this might actually work out quite well for him. Blood Dragon on top of that top. And Nurok getting pushed out, but he pops the Hyperion. This is going to push Ultimate back here. But not Adrin. Wow. Being quite ballsy here. He does have the Resurrection up if he needs to.
Look at how low Krolu is at the back right now. He has to focus his heals on himself before anyone else right now.
And in fact, that's the next fort going down. And ETC already marching down onto the bottom key. What a strong push here. Nice options they have with that split push. Chris will have to get out of there. There's the pushback and the storm. Needs to watch out.
Huge stone skin. He's got his Q up very shortly. It's up in 2 seconds. He's going to Q past. Wouldn't expect to see a face melt if anyone jumps on him. But ETC, he's so slippery. And yet, look at what he did. He got the bottom wall. Yes. He's exhausted the tower of bullets. Got rid of half of them on the keep. And just done a little bit of damage. But even so, the power of ETC while the rest of your team have full control of the map, it's just so immense. And they've got a whole level lead now. They're going to get another Terra here. They may even look to soak up mid lane using Blood Dragon here as he exited the Terra and try and seek the fight 20-19.
Yeah, they can definitely do it. Just a little bit more XP to go for that. Ooh, nice little Void Prism. I think it's just going to be for disengage once again. Yeah, and so it is. Yeah, they know level 20 is just going to be way too scary for them. And just going to rotate down, grab those seats, all the seats they can. It should be the next Garden Terror or Team Dignitas, though. It's going to be hard to counter, especially with those walls down in bot lane already.
I'm interested to see what Stitches takes at, level 20 here, because of course he could have taken Hardened Shield, make him a bit more of a tanky tank, but instead he went for Blink. We've got triple Blink here coming out.
Well, they already have double Stone Skin, so that means they can be a little bit more risky now with their plays. So I do like this. I like this idea. Having double Stone Skin, yep. And of course Blood for Blood on Rhaegar, does give him a little bit more sustain, which they already have with that build. And going for Ball of the Storm just makes opens up a little bit more options.
And now again, Alternate have nothing to do but to fall back to their Merc camps before Dignitas grab their plant. And it looks like Dignitas wants to a little bit of communication problem there. Chris wanted to start the top easy camp, but Blood Dragon took the plant before he was able to start it. So that would have created an immense amount of map pressure in two lanes, but instead they've only got mid lane, and it's the lane the plant is going to go down as well. If they'd had it out on top, it would have pushed back the top wave. Meanwhile, in bot lane, they're having to use Alan down bot right now. His Void Prison isn't off cooldown yet, so he's just here dealing with Chris and dealing with the split push of ETC, but he's going to have to join his team.
He needs to get back really fast. They need to rally up again. Otherwise, their keep might fall. It's two Seed Shines. Maybe they can stop him before Blood Dragon gets there, but he's just going to rotate down, go for that keep. And there's the first pot. The remainder of his team just joining now. So they're giving him a little bit of time to react. Alternate actually got rid of those Seed Shines in mid lane and are now there in their entirety here to stop this. They still don't quite have level 20. They need a little bit more XP to go for 20. Just a few more minions to make it happen.
Yeah, we have another plant pot in 5 seconds, so Blood Dragon's going to hang around here, dump another one. There is level 20.
We have Rewind on Zeratul, Annihilating Spirit on Nazibo, there's the Twilight Archon on Tassadar. and the improved Apocalypse on Diablo, and of course Divine Hurricane on Mr. Uther.
So think about the situation now, so close to the base of Alternate. Diablo goes in, dies. Apocalypse. On respawn, because he has souls and can more or less resurge, he uses his ultimate. Apocalypse, that's two times. Then runs into the team again, dies again. That's a third Apocalypse. Hopefully by then his team have done some damage, but speaking of damage, they're going in onto Bloodred.
And there's the Apocalypse coming in onto Blood Dragon, but it doesn't do all that much. Alternate already pushed back. Alan needs to get out of there. And Diablo is back. He should be joining the fight once again. Didn't make the full use out of this Apocalypse. His team didn't really capitalize on it. There's the overturn onto Salus. And a nice Apocalypse follow-up. Salus does fall. Alan is quite low, and Blood Dragon is healed back up. So they have to get out. Nurok might die, but there's the Bolt of the Storm to get out of that fight safely. Chris caught up behind enemy lines, but I don't think they have enough damage to stop him. But do they? Alan is trying it. Trying to go for Blood Dragon now, and they have him in the sandwich, but there's the Gorge, and another nice heal to keep him back up, and Adrian pops out, and so Stitches falls.
Nurok here is trying to kite, but they really don't want to do any damage to Ardren. In fact, they re-engage with the stage dive.
Oh, that might have been a nice option. Nurok is going to fall, but Tesla also drops quite low, and Chris has quite a bit of damage in here, and could go for Gloohammer or Krolu. They're going to watch out, still go for that chase. Where's the Overtorn? They might not even need it. Nope, there's the final kill. Final blow by Krolu, and what a nice turnaround. Only Rhaegar surviving that fight. That's going to give him a little bit of breathing room.
Yeah.
Maybe turn this game around.
Not only gives them breathing room, it gives them hope. Hope that they can actually win a team fight and snowball this game in their favor, or at least turn the tide. Right now, they're still a level behind, but levels don't matter right now. Damage, the difference between the levels is very minimal percentage-wise. They've got the same talents. You usually look to fight when, say,
it's going to come down to map control and getting more chambers.
Yeah.
Or denying chambers if they can. I don't think it's going to happen. Cooldowns are almost up. Stitch is already back. ETC is going to wait a little bit longer, 20 more seconds. Rainer, 10 seconds. But it's not going to give him enough time to go for both Garden Terrors and get all seeds. But they're going to get quite a few more. See, there's the Hearthstone back.
Yep. They need to deal with this top lane right now. ETC could easily just go and sit up here. If this wave wasn't taken care of, the towers would be very low on mana. ETC could have just gone up there and split push, but they had to deal with that, and they may even look to seek a fight for this top Garden Terror. It wouldn't do either team any good. And for once, they've put ETC in the plant instead of Blood Dragon, realizing that with Blood Dragon outside, there is the massive risk of hooking someone in, and that would work so well for Dignitas.
Yeah, maybe they can do it. There's Void Prism, and Adrian coming in with the Apocalypse. It actually hit Blood Dragon. There's a nice follow-up with a great Divine Hurricane. Blood Dragon caught up between Alan and Gloohammer, but Chris is pushing them back, and Blood Dragon Bolt of the Storm out of there. Rhaegar is on the run, but he doesn't get too much damage onto him. And they're pushing Chris back. I don't think it's going to be too many more kills, but Chris is getting stunned here and being sandwiched in between all these heroes. Gloohammer needs to watch out, though. He's a little bit squishy to actually stop him. And Alan being pushed back and polymorphed here. So Chris, I think he's going to survive this.
Well, he is an ETC.
He's in another sandwich. Could stage dive out of this if he needs to.
He blinked forward to try and push Ardren and Alan back into his team, but only pushed Alan, who blinked straight out of there. Does he have Rewind up? No, Rewind is not up. It's up in 15 seconds. The Zerat also has a spike in damage then. Diablo going in.
Diablo.
He's happy to die.
Yeah,
he would
I guess
be happy
he is.
To die because, of course, Apocalypse would come off. And it would help his team out immensely, especially if you're not mounted, then you may get hit by Apocalypse.
But the problem is, being so far from your own base, it would kind of be bad for the next team fight or even going for that push. So I think this is definitely the safer route, going for more seeds, maybe getting the next Garden Terror up. I don't think it's going to be enough, but it's going to give him a massive boost for the next night. And there's the stage dive onto Alan. Adrian wasn't caught out in there, and Chris is in the middle of everything. Blood Dragon comes in from the back, and Link heals everyone back up. This is going to be another escape here for Alternate.
They actually want to try and get Nurok here, as we see the sprint in denied. Are they going to get
that's the wrong direction, Nurok, and there comes the Divine Hurricane. It wasn't enough. Mazebo falls, Krolu being chased by everyone, and he also goes down. Ignidas might actually try to finish here. First, they want to get Mopsio.
My apocalypse now just to save Mopsio, but it's not enough.
Oh, I thought he was out.
Void
Prism should have gone down a little bit sooner. Apocalypse comes down, not doing all that much. Nothing at all. Yeah, there's a GG.
Just bypassing
everything, just going straight for the core, and that does seem to be the right decision.
Yeah.
Way too many cooldowns still up.
Adrian's trying to take down Salus, but even so, it just won't be enough. Dignitas are going to take this best of three series 2-1 versus a very hard fought alternate. They're actually going to get a kill on Link to end things, but even so, Dignitas really well played. They were 1-0 down, absolutely destroyed Cursed Hollow. And then this game, I really like best of threes. Even if the first two games aren't the greatest, coming into a game like this, 25 minutes, one level between the two, the team fights at the end were just so back and forth.
Yeah.
And for it to end like that, it's great to see how close these two teams really are.
Yeah, this was perfect. Great series. As you said, I mean, first series looked really convincing by Alternate. Then that amazing move by Dignitas with one of the fastest Cursed Hollow games I've ever casted. And now such a longer, drawn-out game here on Garden of Terror, which was still possible for both teams to win. I mean, Alternate could have made their move, but just got a little bit overeager there in the end and got chased down for the first time in that game, to be honest.